Father, we pray that there's no time or distance in the spirit, and you are with all those of our family members who are far away from now. And God, we pray for your grace and your power to fill their lives. Those who are struggling, we pray for power and strength and healing in their lives, healing in their souls. God, for those who are on top of the world, that they just would share every moment with you, which only fills it more with purpose and power. God, we ask you that you would change our lives by the word spoken today. Already, we are leaning into you as a result of your presence and your truth moving through our lives and our hearts this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Say it like you mean it. Amen. Amen. Well, good morning. If you want to start, we're going to go to Jeremiah 29:13. Not a verse that you are unfamiliar with. I have a lot of word to share with you this morning, and we'll see where we can go. I just have probably a book on this that I'm thinking about putting together, actually. So it's so amazing, and had a chance to share it with the guys in prayer on Friday morning, and I told them the better they pray, the better I preach, because I get all my stuff from them then. And it's really good. They pray the word, which is really fun. So you're allowed to laugh. It's okay. Really, not a problem. Okay, so. Listen, this is not an unfamiliar scripture, but I want to share and unfold it for you, and hopefully you'll have an understanding of kind of where we are. We'll start with verse 11, because we all know it. Oh, sorry about that. Verse 11, we all know. For you know, I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you. Here's the verse that I want you to hear. And you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. Wow. I have been struck with this idea of searching for God lately. Now, I've been a Christian since 1978 in February, so I'm going on 40 years, okay? I have never had a season in my life where I felt the drawing of God like I have this season. And, you know, I get wrecked by it thinking about it. I'm wrecked this morning thinking about it. Wrecked, what do you mean? It means God has softened my heart. He's drawing me to me. Whether I'm abasing or abounding, he's the one I lean into. He's the one I'm looking for. I can't get away from him. I don't want to get away from him. I think about him constantly. I think about him in how I inventory my life, in my temptation ways, in my successful God ways. I just can't get away from the drawing of God. It's a season like no other, and I'm a regular guy just like the rest of you. But in all that I'm around God, all that I've given my life to God, it seems that all the more he's drawing us in. If I could say one thing in this season that we're saying, God is searching for you, but I believe that he has put inside of us a deep desire to know and to search him. When you search for me with all your heart, what does that mean? It just speaks to me about, you know, not just I have to, but I must. Something away from all the shoulds, something away from all the disciplines, which are all great things to keep our lives moving. There's a genuine hunger to know God. Yes. To know who he is, to find out why, how. He is the answer. I've gotten past that. Of course he's the answer to my life. God is who he says he is. God loves us. God loves me. God chose me. I'm choosing him. So that's all good. It's like a marriage after you married so long, and it's just you got all the stuff down. You got all the working down. It's all happening. There's somewhere as you're lying in bed at night or getting up in the morning going through your day, there's a drawing to you to know your wife or to know your husband. Not just work together, but to know, to continue to discover. In a healthy marriage, that is such a wonderful, deep, intimate, powerful part, that to know that person intimately, the great discovery of you, Pat, is just my life's call next to discovering God. And as I reflect on my relationship with the Lord and I walk it out with you, then everybody and everything is a benefit thereof, because it teaches me how to love. It teaches me how to prioritize. It teaches me to set things in order, to choose, to set as valuable the things in life. And as that, I learn to love. I learned to love Pat. I learned to love my sons, my granddaughters, my friends, my brothers, my sisters, even my enemies, honestly. It's an amazing, powerful transformation, an eternal way of living. It's the kingdom of God in us alive. We are sitting in a place that's in transformation. We've been saying this. But what keeps pounding in my heart is this is only a reflection of what's happening in here. If we're going to be a part of a supernatural church, it's going to be us that is this supernatural church, not the facility. It's only a reflection, because as we build it, it should reflect that it's just a part of us. It's just a tool. So we are in an expansion. We are growing. Our hunger for God has expanded our hearts, and as a result, you're changing and I'm changing. And as a result of hunger for God, this is what we see. But that hunger is so important to attend to. That search is important to attend to. Because everything here that would be supernatural must first be supernatural in us. The way we live, the way we think, the overcoming of difficult ways in our hearts, sinful ways or ungodly ways. As we overcome, then it's reflected in where we live and where we dwell. The best thing about this room as we change is you. Because the excitement, the movement of God among us is what people come into. They come into the very atmosphere of God and man coming together, rightfully so and by the design of God. And the mix creates a very atmosphere that men and women step into. This is amazing. It's wondrous. You make a ton of mistakes and God still works with you. It's awesome. I was so pricked about this week. When we are meeting as some community groups, just trying to put together some small groups, secretly leaking it out to you, we're going to get it together. But we met some potential leaders, and David Alas, I don't know if David, you're in here. I'll give him a byline, second service, he'll probably be in. But David shared the story of Elijah in 1 Kings 19, where Elijah, we know the story. You know the story about Elijah, right? Okay, I'll tell you the story. He's just... You should read your Bible. It's better than any TV show on the planet. I want to tell you something. You want to look for crazy, twisted things? Read your Bible. You want to look for triumphant and Boy Scout things? Read your Bible. I mean, there's just some crazy stuff in the Bible that just grips your heart when you read between the lines. I'm a big person about reading underneath. I'll share a little bit about that today. But Elijah, so here he is. He's just stood. There has been no rain on the land for 3 years, and then the rain comes, and then he also destroys the Baal prophets. He has this whole thing where you call the fire down, and we'll soak the wood. Remember the whole story? And it just comes, God just comes, and like, he's such an awesome show-off, and he just comes and just blows the place apart. Then Elijah kills 150 prophets of Baal. Then he's just so shot, and you find him pulling away and going to a cave, and he's just in this cave, and he's just, if you could just understand, he is worn out, and he's thinking he's carrying the whole country and the whole kingdom on his back, and he's just there. I read into this, and in this thing, the word of the Lord comes to him in verse 9, and it says that he says, come out. Well, it says, what are you doing here, Elijah? What are you doing here? Almost like, what are you looking for? What's in your heart? Like, where are you? Isn't that wonderful that God comes to us and finds us when we're weary? Yeah. And we're ignoring him. We've found some cave we can find or some rerun we're watching in our dark basement and we don't want to talk to anybody. This hasn't happened to you, I know. Just other people. So in the garage hiding. I don't know. So he comes to Elijah and he draws him out and he says God comes before him and we know the story. The wind comes. He just rakes the place, the earthquake comes. I mean, just, have you ever been in a windstorm that's over 70 miles an hour? It's ridiculously crazy. Sounds like a freight train. We were down in North Carolina, weren't we, one time? And a hurricane came through, said, oh, it's going to be in the south, don't worry about the north. Oh, it came up to the north. We were right over the eye of the storm. And we were in our place at the time, and this wind came through at 70 miles an hour, sustained winds, and the cottage we were staying was right on the ocean front, and it just kind of rocked back and forth. That's a freaky feeling, seriously. And that wind is like, oh my gosh, it's like powerful. Anyway, so he comes by in the wind, God's not in the wind. He comes by in the earthquake, we know this. He's not in the earthquake. Comes by and a fire, like heat, intensity, consuming. And he's not in the consuming, but he comes then in a still small voice, a silent voice. Here we have the wind. We had the presence of God this morning, the breath of God moving. We have the big, we have the crazy presence and explosion of God and the prophetic word and signs and wonders. We have all that. But of all those things, if you could equate, and David Alas did such a good job of sharing this, David Alas did. But, you know, he said we have all the majesty, all the magnificent. But still when it comes down to it, It's the still small voice that grips a man's heart. It's the personal touch that revived Elijah. When he heard that voice, it was the inside of him, the searching side that said, God, I've done everything, but I'm worn out, and where are you? I'm putting words in his mouth, but I don't think I'm reading his heart. He's worn out and tired, and he wants the essence, the substance, the companionship of God, of which he's been so jealous. He's looking for him, and God answers in that whisper. Wow. Man. When God is speaking and you're dialoguing with him in your life, you're carrying on a personal time with him, the majesty only becomes all the more amplification of who he is. But if we step away from that still small voice every time and get further and further away, then all that majesty just becomes noise. Just noise. It only pounds on your heart that you are not there, maybe reminding you all the more. Maybe alienating you. I don't know. I think it's wondrous that God comes in, and in that great majesty, he pierces a single heart in this room, even this morning. But it's still the still small voice that comes into your heart. Oh, man. Don't you ache for it sometimes or long for it, for God to speak a word? When he can whisper, man, it's amazing how the reverberation goes through your soul, your mind, will, and emotions, and brings you back to life. Elijah gets up, wraps his mantle across his face, and goes, steps out. And then God speaks to him. And he speaks as he, and what's so wonderful, God waits. He lets him talk and he listens to him. And then he tells him, go back, return. Go anoint this guy, go anoint that guy. And there's verse 12, there's 7,000 that have not bowed their knee to the Baal prophets or kissed him. It goes on to say that. There's a word for prayer. Isn't that a word for prayer? You don't think God knows this when you bow your knees to him and pray in some isolated place, you put time in a furnace, or you kneel beside your bed at night, he counts on that. He knows where your heart is kept for him, and it's circumcised for him, and it's moved toward him and stepped away from temptation or giving yourself to some other God, and he sees you are chased toward him. And he saw the whole country of Israel and said, I've counted everyone, and there's 7,000. Who maybe they weren't meeting in some place together, but they were there. Wow. What an encouragement to a man who felt he's completely alone. What a paradigm shift. Wow. I submit to you that in this moment, Elijah was searching. He was looking for God. He was looking for that connection. Where are we this morning? Is your search on, or you've put it on, backed off, and just parked it? Where was the last time God beckoned you, drew you, spoke to you? If we aren't doing this, then this is all just smoke and mirrors. I love you. I'm encouraging. Don't be so quiet. He's just wondrous. What I want to tell you is he is speaking to us. He is drawing to us. But lift your head up. Take a look. Turn and lean into him. That's the only thing that's contagious and worth sharing among us. We're all here, and we've been leaning into them all week, and then we're tired like an Elijah. Come here and see that there's 7,000 parallel, and we incur our hearts leap right away. Then we're all leaning into God. Then that every person coming in is the benefit of that. We just join in this great crescendo, this symphony of each one playing their part and going after God. Then, baby, oh, it's heaven on earth when you step in here. And I'm talking real stuff. Roll your sleeves up, love God, and let's go. How are we doing? Come on. So many scriptures. Jeremiah 29:13, Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things be added unto you. Even Deuteronomy 4, verse 29 says, seek the Lord with all your heart and with all your soul. What does that sound like? Sounds like Deuteronomy 6:5. Just seek the love of the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Sounds like Mark 12, verse 30. Matthew, I forget the one in there. I can pull it up. But Mark 12, verse 30. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. What a commandment. Jesus speaking to the rich young ruler who had stature and saying, this is the first commandment with blessing. Wow. I don't want to forget. And then on top of it, we're in a season where God is drawing. And God is giving us the grace to pursue him in the morning, in the middle of the day, in conflict. The Beatitudes, chapter of Matthew 5, all the way through, verse 3, all the way through 12, you can see it. It's all stories of those who are poor in spirit, recognizing they are less than and feeling insignificant. Those who mourn, who are brokenhearted, lost what they have wanted almost as dear to them, they're reaching out to God. Those who are meek, who have power but have decided to control that power before the Lord. Those who are hunger and thirst, that long for a deep relationship with God. Those who are persecuted, those who are peacemakers, it says right there. Not just that they're peacemakers and they have it all together, but they're people. Every one of these show a conflict in life that as you have, there's a bend or a gifting in that person, and they must reach into that gifting and use it in order to get through that conflict in their lives. Because the Amplified says, the touch on it is, no matter what condition, regardless of the condition, outward condition they are in, the peacemaker, regardless of the outward condition they are in, the mournful, regardless. Do you see what I'm saying? The Beatitudes is what Christ said to us and said, look, no matter what, you'll have trials and tribulations. John 14, John 16. But if you could reach through as I am with you, reach through, that's the transformation. Your hunger and search for me as I have bent you and made you. Come on. Of all people, Christians should know how to survive or thrive under suffering and conflict. We've written the book because we have the writer in our hearts. So no matter where you are, we spend so much time trying to get away from the conflict, but affluence is a huge seductive spirit. Because the more we're affluent, the more it's all good, the more we lose our edge, if I can submit that to you. Where are you today? Where's the conflict? Where's the challenge? And are you using the bend of God in towards you, inside of you, to lean into him? Brian, a truth seeker. My son, a truth seeker. They look for the truth wherever they are. I'm different. I look for the love. I look for the relationship. It all depends. It just depends on what you are. But can you see how Jesus was speaking to men to bring encouragement to them, not admonishment? Look, I've made you a certain way. No matter what conflict, no matter what the outward condition is, regardless, reach up. If you have power and are tempted to use it, hold it and let it be controlled by me. You're meek. If you're mournful and lost to everything, look to me because I will give you what you have been lacking and I'll fill in the gaps and your heart will expand because you'll be able to overcome the loss that's there and still hold on to me. Now stepping into an eternal perspective rather than a temporal perspective. Trusting my character. Wow. These words are the tip of the deep trust and truth of the iceberg of God's kingdom behind it. And his kingdom is the relationship we have with him. How fantastic. Open our eyes, God. Open our ears. Help us not to be dull and deaf, come on, to our circumstance and situation. Help us to believe wherever we are counts, no matter what. That we have a reach, that we have a circumference, we have an influence that, God, you can make a difference through. And as you change my life, my heart's expanded for those around me that you can change theirs. Oh, yeah, you're going crazy. So many amazing things. Scripture is filled. I haven't been this flooded with scripture in how many ways that searching goes through the Bible. We search for all kinds. We seek for all kinds of things. But for today, I know we can seek for items. We can seek for goals. We can seek for people. But for today, I'm talking about searching for God, seeking God. Every man, it has accorded them the opportunity. Every man has that. Every man, woman, child, has that desire to know God. Scriptures talk about it. Take some time to look up the word search, seek. Seek is seeking, searching, hungering, hunting. It says everything in the translation says everything from investigating to following, to discover, to craving. The actual word craving there. Craving God. Oh, man. When you feel those things, lean into them and go after it. One other quick story. I got two other stories and then I got tons of scripture, but there's this amazing moment in Joseph's life. Joseph, the son of the whole gang, you know, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and then there's Joseph. You know the story about him, right? He had all the brothers, the 12 tribes of these guys. And in the story in Genesis 37, I'm better at telling you a story, but you can take a look, Genesis 37, verse 15. There's a story about that Joseph, and I just love this. It's such a weird little note in this. But Joseph has just had this big fuss with his brothers. He's gone out and told them his dream that, you know, they've been out in the field. He told them his dream that they're all going to bow down before him. And then he has another dream he tells, and he goes and tells his father that he's going to bow down before him. And then, you know, he's already had this coat of many colors. Know the story, right? Thank you. Okay, thanks, really. Okay, so like, you'd be surprised when people don't know. I'm trying to tell you, I'm just trying to check. But, you know, this is just a wonderful story. And so, he's been in a big fuss with his brothers, but he comes back, he tells his father, Jacob, Jacob talks to him about tempering it, you know, even after he tells him a story about Jacob bowing down to him, it's like, oh, man. And so Joseph is just so full of himself and so full, and he's greatly anointed, and he's the guy, God's on him, but he's got to learn to walk in humility. He's got to learn to wait on God, and oh, baby, is he ever going to? Oh, oh, because the bigger the call, that's a hard deal. So, yeah, you want to be Heidi Baker, pay the price, okay? You want to be Bill Johnson, pay the price. You know what I mean? Billy Graham, it's okay. You got to run into it, but trust me. Okay, all right, never mind. Something like, woof, right over. Okay, here we go. So Joseph is out, and so he sends him out. You know, Jacob's worried about the guys with their, you know, the flocks, and he sends him out. Now, if you read between the lines, this is so weird because he goes out into the field, and he can't find his brothers. Now, they're in the area of Shechem, which is kind of difficult because about 7 or 10 years before, the brothers had struck a revengeful death blow to that whole area of Shechem because Dinah, their sister, had been violated by one of the princes. Know the story? And so they waited for the men to be circumcised, and then they're in a weak state, and they went and slaughtered them all. It's a huge shame against Israel and Jacob and the whole crew. It's a bad call. So this is only 7 years afterwards. So they're hoping that it's quieted down and they're trying to feed their flocks and herds. Understand? So now you see them between the lines. So they're probably moving around quietly and trying not to be picked up, okay? So Joseph, who's a young man, probably in his late teens or early 20s, he's going out to see this and find his group. Now, he knows the land as much as any of them, but he can't seem to find them. And he's looking all over, can't find them. He camps at night, gets back up, looking for them, camps at night, gets back up. And so he gets up one morning, maybe it's cold, and he's looking around, and he found a man who found him in a field, it actually says there. It says, found Joseph in a field. So, and he asks the man, well, so I'm looking, he said, the man says to him, what are you seeking? And he says, I'm looking for my brothers. And he says, well, I heard them say that they're going to Dothan. And so they go on to Dothan. So, but if you read under the story, if you just look at this, here's Joseph. He's looking all around. Maybe he gets up one cold morning, and he's just shaking the cold off of him, and he's looking for his brothers, scanning the area. It's hard to see shepherds during the day, not at night because the campfires go, so you can see them. But in the morning, you can't see them. But maybe he runs into this man, or he sees a fire, and sees this man at the fire, and he sneaks up to spy on him. You know, I just imagine stuff like this. Is this okay? And so the man, you know, maybe he's not even has his back to him. He says, why don't you join me? I just don't think that this man found Joseph walking around the field. I think the man let Joseph find him. But that's just my imagination. And he says this word to him, like, how would he know Joseph? How would he even know who his brothers are? How would he even know that, all of that? Because they're trying to sneak around this area. But he says, what are you seeking? This is such an outtake, precursor, preeminent to where Joseph is about to go. Because in this moment when he goes to Dothan, they are so angry with him that they beat him up, cast him to well, and they sell him as a slave to the Bedouins, and they take him away, right? Did God? Did you ever ask God a present question, and he answers you with a forever answer?
Yes.
Oh, man, what are you seeking, Joseph? It's like it's reverberating to the very beginning of his life, and it's going to carry him through the rest of his life. Who is this man? No one even knows him in Scripture. Was it Christophany? Was it Christ? Was it God? Was he long-bearded? Was he hooded? And was he just cooking over a fire, inviting Joseph to come and speak to him? In a chance meeting, in a moment, he says this question to him that just racks his soul for the next several decades. What are you seeking, Joseph? You've got the anointing. You've got the word of God on your life. You have the favor. What are you really looking for? Man. Joseph spends the next two decades answering that. He gets thrown into prison. What are you looking for in prison? He gets raised up to abounding. What are you looking for? What are you seeking, Joseph? What he's really looking for is God. If I got it all, what does it count? It has to have purpose. He learned to have all and not have anything in a moment, several times. He's learning. God is teaching him to what really is important, what he's seeking. How beautiful. How awful. How amazing. His life is ups and downs. Come on. Look at it. What is God saying to you? Where is he driving you? Where is he drawing you? What is he teaching you? You could use it for someone near you. You could use it in the future. You could use it now. Count it. Look at it. Inventory it. Pay attention to it. The search for God that we have. It's our common denominator in this place. We're all looking for the more in him. There has to be more. 99% of us hit that door because that's the reason we're here. God, you have answers. I can't figure it out. I trust your character. I love you. There are four things that I break down search in. Let me give them to you, okay? Think about them. They're my four things. If you don't like them, pick your own, okay? Seriously. I thought about search. What do you do when you search for something? Last time I lost something, which I don't a lot because I'm a pretty habitual guy. I'm pretty habitual guy, okay? Okay. Oh, jeez. Okay. Well, this is going to be fast, okay? You ready? Oh, man. Okay. I'm going to list some stuff. Anticipation. There's four of them, and I'll give them to you. Anticipation, imagination, participation, determination. Come on, each part. Last time you lost something, you look for your pattern. What it represents, what is. Anticipation is what is. What do I know for sure? What are the facts? What are the patterns? What do I know for sure? If you lost your keys, where is the last place I put them? Where do I always put them? Where I tend to put them? Where would they normally be? Are you tracking with me? Okay. Oh, there's so much of this. Come on, the wise men are out of Matthew 2. They looked at the stars. What could be happening? What do I know? Let's pursue. There's just tons of this right there, okay? Anticipation. When they went to the gate beautiful after Jesus had raised up from the dead, Peter, James, and John are going into the gate beautiful. The guy who's lame there, who's been there all the time, asking for alms. Are you tracking me? Okay, good. So they turn to him, and he looks to them as if they're going to give him something. And they say, look at us. And when they said, he says, he looks to them. And the word there, the inference there is he anticipates. What's the difference between every day that he sat there looking for alms, and every day he was asking, is this day he was anticipating. This day he had seen a pattern. This day he had seen the truth come into people's lives. He'd saw the movement of God, and the 3,000 come to Christ. And that day, he knew based on that, the information he had, he had developed an anticipation. When they said, look at us, he looked at them as if they were going to give him something. And when that changed everything, and they said, rise and stand in the name of Jesus, and they lifted up his hand and he got up. What's the difference in anticipation? He had seen a pattern. He had seen the truth. He had known at least what is happening. God is moving in this city like never before. But Jesus had walked all around, had walked past that guy 62, 11 times. You know what I mean? But this one was different because this man had been stepped in anticipation. The wise men, Simeon and Anna, anticipating the arrival of the Christ. Man, they had their facts, they were ready. Man, the Bible is full of anticipation. What do we know? What do you know about God this morning? Where's the last place you are absolutely sure? What are the facts and the truth about him? What's the information you know? And that's the pattern. Go back to what we know about him. Start with that. Number two, imagination. From there, what could be? What can be? Imagine. One of the greatest things we have in our lives is imagination. Why should we let the world system steal it from us? Guard your heart with all diligence. Out of it flow the issues of life. Guard your imagination. Imagine the great things that God can do. Based on your anticipation, now where could he move? Where might he move? Where does he want to speak to? What do I think I could work with him on? Man. But we got to be living in what we know. Then we got to move into what could be, what can be. Use your imagination. What was the last time you imagined with God? Man, Ephesians 1, 17 through 23, 1 Corinthians 2, 9. The eye is not seen or ear heard. The amazing things, I'm paraphrasing, that God can do through us. But baby, I'm going to try and imagine it, right? Everyone, look at Scripture through the power of imagination, that God is constantly drawing us up and to see where he is, up and to see his possibilities and his powers to overcome. Certainly it's the natural, and we appreciate that, but this is the supernatural, which is real. Real. What have you imagined lately? What have you cast out in God and believed him for lately? Man, there's so much to believe for, starting with my transformation myself, then a faith for the transformation of others. What can you imagine? Scriptures are full, and I'm going to just, there's just so much in this to share. But okay, let's just move to the other one. Participation. The great power to step out, what to do. What to do? What is called as God called us to do? What can be done? Naaman, when he was a great warrior and had leprosy, being eaten from within, powerful on the outside, but dying on the inside, and it's becoming to show as a leper, a little servant girl who is a Jewish gal who had been captured by the Babylonians, and it was the Babylonian Empire, she said, "My God could heal Master Naaman." And Naaman got that word. It cut into his heart, and then he acted out. He went and saw Elijah. Elijah said, "Go to the Jordan, the muddy waters, and go and dip yourself seven times." We know the story, yes? And he was like, "Whoa, I want to do something amazing." The guy said, "Well, but if he asked you to do something amazing, you wouldn't have done it. Why don't you just do the simple thing?" Go home on that word right there. Why don't you just do the simple thing God asked you to do, all right? Let's start with that, okay? Talk nice to your wife. Love your kids. Be true, be pure, stay clean. Not a bad start. I'm like, gosh, I go crazy on this. And he does exactly what he says, and he gets totally healed. These are just some of the scriptures, some. Participation. We were built to walk and work with God. As he stretches out his heart, we stretch out our hand. If he feels compassion, we fill our lives with concern for others. And we are meant, heaven and earth, working together. It's not odd. It's perfect. It's amazing. It's wondrous and wonderful. Yes. Last one. Determination. Determination. Oh, my gosh. Read Hebrews 11. By faith. By faith. By faith. Men who were, the world was not worthy in the very end, 11, 32 to 34, sawn in two, lived in caves, had sheepskins on them. Can you imagine? These guys were tenacious and didn't give up. Sometimes, Christendom, just let me just admit this, weird, bizarre thought. Oh, we tried it once, but it must not be the Lord. Are you nuts? Seriously. Most of the stuff God asks us to do, it's repetitive. It's the participation consistently and regularly until you break through. It's not denial. It's not brainwashing. You know that you know. You know God can heal. You know he can love that dumbbell that you work with. You know that he loves, and you stay in the harness, and you still do it. And you do it, and you do it, and you do it, and God breaks you because you're getting changed, reformed, and then they get better, all right? Determination is full of it. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame. Man, the Bible, just like each part of this just opened up as you read through and see this. We can't be faked out by the world, by the fake news of the world. The fake news of the world system. Like, oh, you can't do that. Really? Oh, stand up. Oh, my gosh. I wish we had like 3 years to do this. All right. Come on. God, we want, we hunger, we search for you. God, spend our life discovering your massive creativity, your brilliance. Spend our life enjoying your company. You're just such good company. You're not stuck up or religious. You're real, and your words weigh into our hearts, just in genuine, normal conversation. God, may we anticipate you at every turn. May we imagine way beyond where we are right now. The road is in front of us and you are with us. There's some bumps, but God, who else has the words of life? Thank you for inviting us to participate with you. It makes the rubber meet the road, God, when we participate with you. We're astounded that you're right beside us in our mistakes and our victories. Help us not to give up so easily. Your word in our heart, and our agreement with you and your will and ours combined make the difference for our families, our marriages, our workplaces, the assignment you've given us now, wherever we are. Thank you for this. Make us different. Thank you for loving us the way we are. Really loving us right now. The way we are, signed, sealed, delivered, you love us. That only makes us want to be more like you. Open our lives to us, God, that we see the course in front of us. These days as they unfold, that we won't waste them. We're not haggard or impressed. We're just intentional with you as you bring things before us. Let your kingdom come into our lives. The rule of you over our hearts. Your truth and your wonderful ways of being. Your power, your immovableness, and yet you're moving everywhere. Thank you. Reach out, grab a hand or a shoulder, whatever's appropriate. Let's just encourage one another. And we pray for each other, God, that we would become a mighty army, but a wonderful family. God, let your supernatural enter our hearts. God, every day, the everyday is so amazing with you. We appreciate your peace. Let it spread abroad in our group and our families, but also your zeal as well. Hunger for you. Increase the search for you among us. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Well, have a great week. All right. Bless you. Ministry team, please come forward. And we're always praying for healing, praying for a point of contact, praying for a point of faith. All right. Bless you. You're released.